the exercise, unknowingly we do justice and getting into what is famously called Foucauldian way of looking at social sciences. Unknowingly, subconsciously. So what Foucault reminds us that when you do that exercise, then you, what you do, that you make individuals disciplined and governable population. They are no longer citizens. So we may pay attention to the distinction between whether you are surveying a population or you are surveying a citizen. So are tribal citizens or tribal population? Let me tell you, I have worked with UNDP, World Bank, etc., etc., and it's not something that I have not spoken from the forums. All these multilateral agencies have written a long paper published internationally where I'm looking at why these disciplinary biases distort their knowledge systems. They come, ask us to do the survey and the research, and they look at all these marginal groups, and poor groups, vulnerable groups as population rather than citizens. So it's very important that what kind of epistemological damage we are doing to ourselves and to the people we are researching with. So no wonder the role of the new social scientist is to reveal disciplinary powers. And that contests notions of order and the structures of dominance. But let me also acknowledge that there have also been economists and anthropologists who have engaged constructively with the work of other groups. For instance, Clifford Geertz has shown that the intense bargaining and the client cultivation of markets in Morocco were the results of poorly distributed information and noisy communication networks. And then our own, Amartya Sen's work. If you are a researcher, you must consider, looking at comprehensive outcomes and culmination outcomes methodologies of Professor Amartya Sen, which famously led us to explore the idea of freedom and individual dignity. Of late, in the last 20 years, the word dignity, what dignity has hit us hard in social sciences methodologies. We need to be careful about what Amartya calls, this whole idea of enfranchisement and entitlement through capability development. So therefore what I'm arguing, and I have argued so far, to make a case for methodological pluralism or conversation across disciplines and methodologies. I have limited time. It's a very, huge paper. I might, with the permission and approval of the Vice-Chancellor, I will circulate my paper. I will send you so that you can benefit from this paper. This is going to come out as a long research paper in the journal. But you can use this paper. You can cite as a draft paper. So what I'm trying to do at this end, to conclude this part of my presentation, making a strange familiar. What appears as strange as a researcher is basically is basically more familiar to us. So therefore, although we recognize the conventional distinctions between qualitative methodology and quantitative methodology, but I've also brought to the fore a methodology that I use extensively when I'm working on poor, marginalized, and vulnerable groups, participatory methodology. In fact, I would like Professor Katimuri to reflect on that. Even when we are doing translation, I'm running a platform of translation across Indian languages. We also like to deal with, a participation, a sort of, with the language, with the culture, a sort of a deep participation. So if you do deep participation, just go through Professor Katimuri's own translation, and you will find that how he's translated across languages and literary tradition because of his ability to cross what I call thin participation into a thick participation. So we need to consider, participatory methodologies as well. So what I'm going to do, I will send you that you read, the quantitative and qualitative and different aspects of quantitative methodologies and qualitative methodologies. And I was sharing with your, course coordinators. So of late, I'm also under extreme pressure, the pressure of the market. I won't deny that. I don't have pressure of the market. So in fact, in this, of late, I have revised methodology paper and looking at big data, artificial intelligence, machine language. I think these are different, computational methodologies, different programming methodologies. And I was very happy when I looked at your program that you're putting focus on different, computational methodologies, looking at how big data could be useful. And I don't know if someone is here to also talk about RCT, randomized control trial. And this has come as a practitioner and as also professor of, you know, social sciences methodology, I often speak to, you know, students, what do you want to learn? And one of the demands that came from a student body was RCT, because RCT, if you are armed with RCT, you get better jobs, you know. I mean, like, you know, Jameel Lab, where people like Abhijit Banerjee and Duflo, so they also sent a message that, Ashwini, why don't you do big data and RCT? You are so competently, you know, doing your work. Because if you do RCT, you know, randomized controlled trials. So, for instance, in a school, there are two sets of group. One set of students doing badly, the other set of students doing good, you know, in terms of educational outcomes. And this is very relevant here, Amarkantak, you know. So when you go to a medical dispensary, you know, or the doctors, you know, you can create a control group and a trial group. And through these methodologies, what they call famously, you know, Abhijit Banerjee and Duflo, through their MIT work, you know, the poor economics, what they call evidence-based social science, evidence-based social science, almost irrefutable. And I'm told that the Prime Minister Modi also invited Duflo and Abhijit Banerjee to expand, you know, their methodology into assessing and evaluating Swachh Bharat and other programs, you know, because somehow in the government when I worked with, I found them a little kind of uncomfortability, you know, dealing with other branches, you know, for instance, sociology, anthropology, at the end of also when I was in 2009-10 in Government of India, so the finance secretary would always tell Maya Ram, who is from Jaipur, the prof, give us more evidence-based, you know, I love your narrative, but at the end of the day, when we are going for budget presentation, we need data, we need numbers, you know, number crunching, you know, how many people have failed, how many people have passed, you know. So this is also interesting, and this is also important. But at the same time, as I started out saying, that the whole universe, the phenomenological universe, ethnographic universe is missing here. But when you work with the World Bank, you know, UNDP, and the government, you know, various governments, it's not just limited here, you know. All over the world I have worked in many, you know, including China I worked. There also, you know, the first reaction is to just look at number, you know. How many students have failed? How many students are sick, you know? And as a Vice Chancellor, Professor Katipuri is facing that situation every day, you know. So we need that kind of, you know, information, that kind of analysis. So machine language, artificial intelligence, I'm just saying that it's not necessary that you have to do in your current PhD, but you need to be sensitive to what's happening around you, you know, because you will become irrelevant. You will become dinosaurs, let me tell you. I'm coming from New York and California and Berkeley, more famously Berkeley, where most of the things are happening, you know. It's like, you know, when the Tesla car I drove, it's not driving, it's a driverless. It's run by robotics. It's run by machine language. So it's interesting. So as a researcher, I'm sensitive. As a researcher, I'm cognizant of, you know, this new methodological, computational, you know, experimentation that's happening in the field. But at the same time also, what I'm asking here to do is to create conversation across disciplines, you know. So for me, hostility is not important, you know, between quantitative and qualitative. And look, and I just caution you, and with a deep respect and humility, that if you are, you know, there is a process, underlying process, an unconscious process of stigmatizing in social sciences methodology. So if you do qualitative or participant observation or participant methodology, there is a stigmatization, you know. There is a kind of a caste system, you know. And economists, please don't get offended. The new Brahmins, you know, the new culture is based on, you know, more positivistic or new positivistic traditions. So they always privilege empirical methodologies, you know, positivistic methodologies, quantitative methodologies. So please don't care about, you know, in your research, if you're doing ethnography, if you're doing anthropological or visual anthropology analysis. So when I went through this university, one of the striking things I find this university is the visual anthropology, the murals, you know, all over. That tell me the story. That tell me the people they are. And then I need the number, you know. So what I'm arguing here is to be conscious of your own disciplinary phenomenological status in the social sciences without being stigmatized, you know. So when I go to Sussex and do work on participatory methodology, which is not a mixed methodology, let me caution you. Mixed methodology or hybrid methodology has become a fashionable term, but the participatory methodology is something requires a deep engagement with the people we are researching, right? in the tribal context, in the Dalit context, in the feminist context, you know. So that's very important. So I'm now, if allow me to conclude, and conclude in the sense that what I'm trying to, you go through the paper and look at, look for your comments and observation on my paper so that I can do a better job. So if you're doing focus group and you are doing visual techniques in participatory methodologies, so it's not just qualitative, quantitative universe I'm looking at. I'm going beyond that. Why do I go beyond these methodological divides and hostilities? Because there are three important terms for me here in research. A, equity. Equity, you know, that's coming from Amartya Sen's capability theory. Second, the voice term, voice. Voice is very important, you know. Voice is something that's important to contest disciplinary powers, and I've learned from feminist research, Dalit research, and the tribal research, you know. And then the empowerment, you know, So if my research, you know, there is a sense, you know, among researchers that at the end of the day, when I design research methodology section, it's kind of very routine, you know, mechanical section. You know. I have to simply say what kind of, you know, methodology I'm doing it. We need to ask ourselves that if this methodology is helpful, you know, in terms of empowering the people you are looking at. I mean, this question we need to ask. Otherwise, your methodology is misplaced. Your methodology is not connected to what Amartya famously called comprehensive outcomes, you know, rather than culmination outcomes. So as a development practitioners and research and policy scholars, we need to be careful about looking at aggregate data and also looking at a specific, you know, variations and trajectories in both a spatial sense and a sociological sense. So we do recognize that the significance of evidence-based research methodology is very important, but also at the same time, we need to look at, you know, how my research is beneficial across disciplines and across peoples of various social backgrounds, you know. So to conclude, what I would argue, that as Niti, I'm using Niti in terms of public policy, relates to organizational property and behavioral correctness, and assesses the role of institutions in the development research, a focus on equity, voice, and empowerment on poor are more famously and precisely NYAY, justice, allows us to reflect on the lives people are actually able to lead. It is this shift from transcendental institutionalism to realization-based or justice-based participatory equity research methodology that I'm trying to bring to your attention. This also signals a methodological departure from assessing culmination outcomes. So you have taken one roti, two roti, or two chapati, and ignoring the question of citizen rights, you know, to comprehensive outcomes. In short, comprehensive outcomes in social science methodology include not only material and physical goals of the social policy, but also refer to enhancing of the capability of poor people in realizing livelihood rights. In developed and developing economies, the poor play a significant role in mobilizing a struggle against those in power. However, they do not exercise independent influence in deciding the relations between the state and civil society. Most of the anti-poverty programs initiated by government are